got a few here remaining. It's good to see y'all in it for the long haul. I appreciate it. Give yourselves a round of applause for making it through the past couple days. Woo! Hey, we still have more incredible content for you guys. You know, as we wrap up an incredible 2 days of networking, learning, we wanted to put together a session that looks a little bit more forward with the real estate industry. So we reached out to our good friends at Keeping Current Matters to get them to come down. Greer Allen, our CEO. Content and marketing at Keeping Current Matters. Finger on the pulse of the real estate industry for the past 20 years. And he regularly contributes to industry and market insights through various webinars, speaking engagements, videos, all with the help of agents becoming more established in their markets. So we're really excited to welcome these two to talk a little bit more about what's going to be coming down the pipeline in the real estate industry. Our CEO, Greer Allen, and David Childers. Thanks, guys.
All right, everybody, how y'all doing? Good unite so far? All right, well, I'm really excited to have David Childers up here with me today. You know, Keeping Current Matters is an organization that puts out some amazing content that really takes all these different media sources and really, you know, brings it all together and puts it in a digestible format for agents to be able to help their clients understand where the market is. And so, first of all, I'd like to ask, show of hands, who has seen a KCM webinar or is a subscriber to KCM? So a good deal of people out there. Awesome.
That's great.
One thing that I heard last night that I didn't want to forget to mention is that you can actually have your blog auto-populate in Boomtown. Yeah. If you're a subscriber to KCM. So if you don't know how to do that, hit up support or hit up your success management team. But it's amazing content and super excited to have you here. Thank you so much for being here, David.
Well, Greer, it's exciting to be here. It's the first live event we've done. Yeah, you can't hear us. There we are. We're back.
There we are. We're back on audio.
It's the first live event that we've been to as Keeping Current Matters. We've done a lot of webinars over the last 12 months, but I am excited to be here. And thank you, Greer, for the support of what we do at Keeping Current Matters. We're grateful for it.
Certainly. So I think, you know, where I'd love to start, David, is just kind of on what you guys are best at, and really just that's digesting all the data and understanding the market. And as we start to look into the second half of this year, what are you guys seeing?
Yeah, let's talk about that. What I'll do is we'll start with the current market first.
Okay, current would be great, yeah.
We'll start off with the current market, and then we'll talk about the second half. Because, you know, here's the ironic thing. Tomorrow is the first day of the second half of the year.
There we go. Perfect
time. It's hard to believe that July 4th this weekend, we're about to enter in the second half of the year. But what I'll do is I'll talk through the current market first, and maybe I'll give a little kind of 15-20 minute presentation. We'll talk about that. I'm going to give you all the slides here, everything that we talk about. You'll be able to download that, so you'll want to grab those. But Greer, I want to start off this way, because you started off yesterday talking about where's the market at using insights, and that's what I love about Boomtown and about you. You look at all the sources, you use the data, and you say, okay, we're going to use that information to make wise decisions. And then Tom came on and he said, you know what? What are clients looking for today? They're looking for certainty. So here's how I would set up our time, and it's this way. In times of uncertainty, people follow the certain. And so what I want to give you are some facts and some figures and all the things that we do at KCM to say, where is the market right now? Where is the market heading so that you're equipped for that? I'm going to go the exact opposite way of every other speaker that's been on stage so far. And I'm going to tell you this. Take a picture of all of the slides that you want to remember. And here's why. I don't know if you'll use them or not. Only you know that. But here's what will happen. Somebody will ask you a question. And you'll say, you know what, I remember Keeping Current Matters talking about that. And I'll be able to pull that up. You'll be able to take those slides and use them. You'll be able to download them and have them in conversation. So let's talk about this. Let's talk about the current market and where we're at right now. I'm going to start talking about buyers. We'll cover buyers first. We'll then cover sellers. I'm going to talk a little bit about forbearance. I know many of you have been on KCM webinars. Those of you that are KCM subscribers, you'll be well prepared for a lot of these conversations. But the most latest information is what I've brought on the current market. So first, we'll go to Ivy Zelman, the June broker report. She said this: this month's overall home buyer demand rating equaled 86 on a 100, 0 to 100 scale, down from 88 last month and marking the first sequential decline since November. Ivy Zelman's a trusted what they have seen here, the first broker survey, they do it every month, of a decline since last November in buyer demand. That's interesting. Let's keep on that train. The Home Purchase Sentiment Index done by Fannie Mae, the percentage of respondents that say now is a good time to buy a home, it's dropped to 35% in May. Why is that a big deal? This time last year, it was over 60%. It's about half. One in three buyers say it's a good time to buy a home. Here's a reality. Perception in today's market is reality. Here's how you know that. You walk out of here today, you go to the street, you start to cross the street, and a car is coming. Your brain's going to tell you, I sense danger. I'm going to back up because I want to stay on this earth a little bit longer. The car is going to pass, and I'm not going to get hit in that scenario. My perception has informed my decision at that point. The reality is perception is informing buyers' decisions right now. What we always want to do is educate buyers and say, okay, if it's not the right decision for you, then we don't want you to make that decision. But if you're making that decision because you've been missing your perception, then that's where we want to step in. So Ivy Zelman's seeing buyers say, you know what? We're not sure it's the right time. Home Purchase Sentiment Index seeing, I'm not sure it's the right time. And oh, by the way, time showing us the same thing. Buyers starting to drop off. And that's the reality of today's market, is that a lot of buyers are going, you know what? I'm frustrated. I've missed out. And I'm not sure I want to continue to do this. Now, we're going to talk in just a minute about what's at stake, but don't miss that point right now. You know, if you follow KCM, we talked about buyer fatigue, and there are five realities right now of buyer fatigue. Record high median price. Now, median price in our business can be misleading because what do we know right now? There are more homes selling on the upper end of most markets than there are on the lower end of markets. Kay Schiller just came out this week and said year over year, home prices have grown by 14.6%. This checks out. There are a lot of people going, you know what? It's getting a little too hot for me. Historically, I don't need to talk about that. Record high percent of sales over the list price. Record low days on market. Historically low mortgage rates. Last year, 16 times the average 30-year fixed hit a new low. And I'm not telling you anything right here you don't already know. But when you look at it in one place and you say, this is what buyers are dealing with, I don't blame folks for saying, you know what, I'm not sure I want to do this. Here's what I would be saying to buyers right now. Here are buyer talking points. Expect a turn in the market in the coming months because it's already happening. You're already seeing buyer demand start to wane. We're on the front end of that turn. But don't be fooled by the front end of this turn. Still hyper competitive. Summer's when serious buyers commit 100%. If you're working with a buyer right now, it may be time to have a hard conversation with them and say, this is the time that you've got to commit 100%. Let's address the realities of the market. Let's address what's going on. Let's talk about that, because the fear right now is if you don't do that, you're going to get left behind. That's the reality that buyers are facing right now. Let's talk about sellers for just a minute. The reality over the last 12 months is that home equity in this country has skyrocketed. $33,000, just over $33,000 is the average gain in equity on a mortgaged home in the last 12 months, according to CoreLogic. average equity of a home in this country with a mortgage on it is $216,000. Think about that for just a minute. $216,000. 38.2% of homes in this country are owned free and clear. And you can see almost 20% has been the increase in equity in the last 12 months in homes across the country. If there's been a shining star of the pandemic, and this started back in the housing crash, it's that people have handled equity differently. There are a lot of lessons learned back then that people said, you know what, we don't want to go through this again. We don't want to face what we faced back then. Sellers are sitting on record equity. Let's see what experts are saying about sellers. Odetta Cushy from First American says this: it looks like existing inventory is starting to inch up, which is good news for more supply. I can't think of a better word than parched for more supply in this case. Hawes says this: we're seeing another significant week over week gain in inventory. Great news for buyers. And Lawrence Yoon says supply is expected to improve, which will give buyers more options to help tamp down record high asking prices for existing homes. Did I mention there's a turn in the market? We're starting to see a turn with buyers, and now we're starting to see a turn with sellers. You know, sitting at home about a month ago, and it was on a Saturday afternoon, and our neighbors knocked on the door. And those didn't sound too out of the ordinary for any of us, but the problem with this is they were on vacation, and now they're knocking on our door. And my first thought was, our daughter's supposed to get their mail, and I'm like, did you get the mail? They're going to go to the mailbox. All this mail's coming out, and I've got to contend with that now. And they knocked on our door, and they said, hey, we're back home from vacation early. And I said, I see that. And they said, we just sold our home. Somebody from California came in sight unseen, paid cash for it, and we're moving. I'm like, don't worry about the mail. They're gone. You know, the reality is if I talk to any of you out there, you'd have the same story of that, of off-market sales, different things like that. Sellers are realizing they've got an opportunity to sell. And we're starting to see that in the data. Inventory levels at the beginning of this year, normally when we get around January and February, they start to inch up. This year, they remain flat. Now, there's two things we want to always look at, and if you've been following KCM, we've talked about this. One is market velocity. The other is active inventory. And we know homes have been sickly. They haven't had a chance to make it into active inventory. But what are we seeing? We're seeing a very quick market right now, very high velocity, and homes are accumulating. And you can see the growth in inventory levels. That will continue. The seller talking points right now. Don't be too unrealistic. We all know sellers that are trying to catch the market. We'll go ahead and we'll price it, and the market will catch it, we'll be okay. Wait, and you'll miss out on an extremely attractive market. The good time to sell has never been higher. And number four, this is the key right here. Price appreciation will moderate as rates and inventory rise later this year. The horizon, that's where we're at right now, but on to see price appreciation moderate. Now, nobody's calling right now for depreciation. I'm gonna get into that in just a minute, but being very open with sellers right now that if you're thinking about doing it, the time is now. You know, they say in our business, nothing changes until everything changes. And one day we'll look back and say, remember when everything was happening? Remember when people were lining up around the corner to go look at a home? And that's changed. What we want to do with buyers and sellers right now is the certainty. We say at KCM, give them the truth and trust their intelligence. The next piece of information I'm going to talk about is a key piece of that, because there are still agents in the market today that are saying, hey, let's wait right now because this market's about to shift. We're about to see a boatload of foreclosures, and we're gonna wait and we're gonna grab all those foreclosures, and that train is not coming. Where that originates from is forbearance. So I'm gonna talk just a minute about forbearance, and in a minute I'll turn it back over to you, Greer. But let's talk about forbearance. That's been the tool that's been given by the federal government to help homeowners weather the storm financially relative to their mortgage payments. And when forbearance started, the experts out there in the media in different places said and every one of them is going to turn into a foreclosure. Why is that? If you remember that, you don't have to qualify for forbearance. All you have to do is say, I need it, you get it, and we're going to move on. And people said, this is going to be a disaster. This will be far worse than what we saw in the housing crisis. But what do we know? We know that it peaked last May. It just almost 8.5% of active mortgages in forbearance. And where we stand today is under 4%, 3.3% of mortgages in active forbearance right now. Okay? We want to watch this because this is something that's going to be talked about in the news. You can hear the millions of people that can't make their mortgage payments right now. It's just not accurate. So what we want to look at is what is happening to those people as they come out of forbearance. So I'm going to break that down for you real quick. Upon exit of forbearance, this goes from the start of exits all the way up June last year until the 13th of this month, 17 days ago. Okay, the green portion there, 45.4% have come out of forbearance paid in full. These are people that I'm not going to say they took it incorrectly, but maybe they see what happens and we're going to address it on the other side. And they came out and they didn't need it. That's not something you're hearing talked about in the housing market right now. You don't turn on the news and somebody says, hey, half the people that didn't make their mortgage payment last year paid off their mortgage or what they owed and they're good to go. You just don't hear it, but that's the reality right now. 37.8%, they went through a workout with their bank. When we started this at KCM, I mentioned that back in 2010, I was holder of REO properties in this country, and the statement we made back then was that the federal government and banks will do everything they can to avoid a housing crisis. And we've seen just that. We're seeing people go through a modification, go through a deferral, go through whatever they need to go through to stay in the home. The ones that we need to pay attention to are the 16.8 that are still in trouble. Now, I'm not saying all of those folks are going to end up in foreclosure, but what I am saying is those are the ones that could. And we're going to take a look at that. If you want to break it down into four categories of forbearance, they're right here. First one, the ones that were in green. Many households will have their income restored as the economy continues to grow, and they don't need it. We talked about those. Two, these are the ones that were in blue. Some people will have their incomes partially restored so the servicer can restructure the loan, go through a modification, rate and term, refinance, whatever that is, and they can move on. This is where it gets interesting. Point three, a group may not see any true income recovery and will likely have to exit the home. However, given the solid levels of equity, they are more likely to execute a pre-foreclosure sale. With that, they can pay what's owed on the mortgage and exit. And oh, by the way, Black Knight just reported that 96% of the homes in forbearance have at least 10% equity. You have 10% equity in your home. You can pay a commission, put a little bit of money in your pocket, and move to the other side of the crisis that you and your family are facing. You want to brag about selling somebody's home over list price? Sell it for somebody that needs it, that needs the cash out of the home, that can then move on with their lives. The reality of number four, some homeowners will have little to no equity in their homes and will face the foreclosure process. That's a fact about our business. We don't wish it upon anyone, but there were people that were in trouble prior to the pandemic and people coming out of this that will need our help. Here's what I'm saying and what I'm not saying. I don't believe this is an issue we need to be silent on right now. I think we need to be shooting videos. We need to be getting this information out in the market. We need to be talking about it. Because this is not a situation where somebody's going to come and knock on your door and say, you know, we're having an issue. This is something that folks don't want to talk about, that we need to get out there and say, hey, if you are having an issue, if you are coming off of forbearance and you want to talk about what your options are, let's talk. The likelihood is in this hot real estate market, you're able to sell your home, put a little bit of cash in your pocket and help you and your family. And we want to get that word out there. But more than anything else, before I turn it back over to you, Greer, I want to talk about what's at stake right now. We talked about buyers that are challenged. We talked about the shift that we're seeing with sellers. The Home Purchase Sentiment Index that just came out that I talked about before just forecasted the next 5 years of home price appreciation. And you can see it right here. This year calling for a little over 8% appreciation, next year 5% appreciation, and then in the years following, more historical appreciation. Historical appreciation in this country has been about 3.8%. The reality right now is somebody that makes a decision to say, you know what, I don't know if I want to continue looking for a home, is making a decision that over the next 5 years on the average priced home would cost them in equity over $93,000. Home today, based on their home purchase sentiment index, $350,000, they stand to gain in home equity $93,000. So my point is, there are a lot of buyers that are out there that are frustrated. I don't know if there are a lot of buyers out there that understand this is what's at stake right now. There are a lot of buyers that are saying, you know what, I'm gonna wait until this may all come crashing down. I'm gonna wait till something different happens and really make a different decision. And we wanna get this word out there.
Although buyers are frustrated, you know, with the process and you know, the multiple offers and having to get multiple houses before they find one, you know, they're leaving a lot of money on the table if they just sit on the sidelines right now. Number two, you know, you've got, you know, this relatively small sliver of the total forbearance projections that quite frankly, I guess 98% of those people have an opportunity to sell before they go into foreclosure.
Right.
So that's another thing that, you know, that everybody should be focused on, you know, trying to understand who those buyers are and market that they can help them, you know, get out of their homes with, yeah, if they do have that 10% equity.
The forbearance and somebody who's been affected is there should not be a scenario where somebody goes into foreclosure 96% of the time.
Right.
The only scenario I can see there is if somebody doesn't understand that they can sell their home, if they're just sitting there saying, we're just waiting to give it back.
Right.
And that, I'm not saying that's not the case. It could be the case. The other thing I would say in that is you're starting to see surveys come out, and many of you have probably seen them, that say millennials and others are having buyer's remorse of the home they bought in the last year. I'd call every one of those folks up and say, are you having buyer's remorse? Because if you are, you can sell right now.
Well, I bought right before the pandemic hit, and it was on that day where the market dropped and the circuit breaker flipped the switch. I was on the way to, you know, to go to the closing, and it was the third circuit breaker trip of the day when I was listening to CNBC. I was frankly freaked out. I was like, what am I doing? But it turned out to be a David, is you know, what are the really good leaders out there thinking about right now as we're going into this shifting market? Where are they focusing their time and energy?
Yeah, I think that's a great point. I think the great leaders in our business right now are starting to see this shift and they're preparing their teams. And my encouragement to you, if you're a leader right now watching this and, you know, whether it's online or here in the room, take all of this and use it with your team to prepare them for the shift. Prepare them for the conversations they have with buyers. Prepare them for the conversations they need to have with sellers. I think that's what great leaders are doing today.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Makes tons of sense. So I tried to jump the gun earlier, second half of the year.
Yep.
We're in the midst of this shift. What's the second half of this year going to be looking like?
Yeah, tomorrow starts the second half. I think the general consensus right now, and I'm going to give you all the forecast and what every expert is saying about that, is a couple of things. Quickly sum it up. The price is going up.
Yep.
Interest rates are going to go up. Prices are going to go up. And there are going to be some headwinds, and I'm going to bring those to you. So we'll talk about those. You want to talk about the second half for just a minute? Interest rate projections right here from Freddie, Fannie, MBA, and NAR. I'm not here to say, okay, where are they going to be exactly when? You can see the estimates right here. They're saying an average of about 3.5% by the middle of next year. The only question is by when and by how much. Be on the lookout for the next couple of months for what the Fed's going to do, what they're going to do with buying mortgage-backed securities, how that's going to impact the market. But no doubt, interest rates, the overall projection is that they're going to go up. And the same is true with prices. These are the top five forecasters of home prices today. Ivy, Zelman, NAR, MBA, Fannie, and Freddie. And the average of the appreciation right now is 8.9%. The interesting thing about every one of these forecasters they all have in common is every one of them have upped their forecast this year as we went along. We started out in January, the average appreciation in homes this year, and we've rocked that up to 8.9 because of the lack of supply across the country. There was a thought that more inventory would come on the market as we rolled into the spring market, and it just hasn't happened. And probably inventory is the bigger question for the second half of the year. There have been three areas that inventory has been forecasted to come from in the second half. Builders, those affected by forbearance, we just talked about that, but I'm gonna break that down a little bit further. And those that put off selling their homes due to the health concerns of last year. People said, you know, we don't want to bring somebody into our home because of, you know, them maybe having COVID back with people. There are a lot of people that put off that decision. Now, I will tell you some interesting information is coming out. Most of us that grew up in the business, the average tenure in a home, everybody moves every 5 years. That's what we knew in the past. We know over the last several years, that's creeped up to about 8 years. Most recently, that's gone even higher to 10 and a half years. People are staying in their homes longer. That's the truth. But let's talk about inventory. You know, Greer, you started off yesterday talking about builders. Is it going to come from builders? Well, builder confidence just came out, but Bill McBride said this, really good source. If inventory increases slowly, house prices will continue to rise rapidly. And if inventory increases sharply, house price growth will slow. That's the reality of inventory right now. I mentioned builders. Are builders building? Yes. Will it be enough to get us through all of this? Can we build our way out of it? We can't. Greer, you started off yesterday talking about that. Yeah. Builder confidence slipped to 81 in the most recent month because of the three L's, lumber, labor, and land. Now, clearly, if you look at this graphic visually, you see that we're ahead of where we were pre-pandemic. But builders are starting to say, you know what? We're having trouble getting supplies. We're having trouble with lumber, and we're starting to see some relief there. And oh, by the way, we have some land concerns. So are builders building? Yes. Starts in the first quarter of this year. A little bit, but yeah, some inventory will come from builders, but not enough to fill the gap of what's needed. Now, if you've followed Keeping Current Matters, you know that we've covered extensively the past 13 years and the gap in this country from the lack of new construction, and literally new construction has not kept up with the pace of you know, population growth. And so we have a severe issue here, but builders are trying their best to make it through it.
Quick question on that. So do y'all have any data on how many homes are being built month over month at this point, and how that compares to the last, you know, 10 years where we only built 6 million?
Yeah, so it's interesting. So the way they look at builds is on an annualized basis. The forecast for this year is around 1.5 million homes. The interesting thing is there were 3 years where 1.5 million homes that was back in the housing crisis. You know, hasn't happened, never happened before, hasn't happened since. But our economy, and builders are no different, is based on innovation. Builders say, hey, it's a great time to be a builder right now. Outside of supply costs and the other issues, they're trying to build them as fast as they can. They have some concerns about interest rates. They have some concerns about costs. They have concerns, but they realize the opportunity in the market. But the quick answer is around 1.5 million units.
Yeah, and builders obviously use a lot of leveraged debt to, you know, to do their operations as well. And so, you know, could interest rates be impacting that sentiment as well?
Well, I think that certainly is the case. But here's the bigger issue. The institutional money is coming into housing. They see housing as a good investment. The outlooks for housing, I just talked about the home purchase sentiment index and appreciation. These big pools of money see housing as a great investment. So publicly traded builders, absolutely, it's a great investment. You're gonna see money flow that way. Builders are gonna try, but they can't fill the gap quick enough for what's there. You know, we talked about forbearance. That was, okay, we're gonna see all these people affected. Well, we're gonna see people affected, but not enough to make up the difference that we need for homes. Right now, 3.93% of mortgages are in forbearance. That's fallen. Between here and the end of the year, about 900,000 homes are expected to come off of forbearance. I want to break down what I just talked about, those that have sufficient equity to be able to sell. And this is how this breaks down. This is very important. Current loan to value, 96% of people have at least 10% equity. That means 4% don't have 10% equity. If we then add to that the deferred interest, that number jumps to 9%. If we add deferred interest and principal, forecasters have pegged those that have a challenge at about 325,000 homes in this country. Now, I'm not saying every one of those is going to go into foreclosure. Don't hear me say that. But I'll tell you this, if every one of them went on the market tomorrow, they'd be snapped up quicker than you can imagine.
David, how does that compare to back in 08 in terms of the equity?
You know, the number of homes.
That's right.
Well, so if again, if every one of those went on the market, you're talking about 325,000 homes, it's not going to happen. That's the worst case scenario. Back in the stretch of the housing crisis, 9 million homes went into foreclosure.
Wow.
Now, what do we know about today? And if you looked at the, you know, lending standards, and we've covered this extensively at KCM, foreclosures have been going down because credit standards have gone up. It's harder to get a loan today, but I don't think people in our, outside of our business, consumers understand that. What they hear is, all right, people are pulling cash out of their houses. Mortgage payments are going up. Folks can't pay their mortgages, and our job is to get the truth out there to them. But when you break that down, it's nowhere near what is being talked about in the media. One area we're starting to see a shift is inventory is coming on the market in different places. Those that have put off selling their homes, those that, you know, I call it the I can sell my home for how much shift, they're starting to come back month over month. Most recent Realtor.com survey, 2.5% growth in inventory. I mentioned before, we're going to start to see that shift. There is one place, we go back to our friend Bill McBride, where he said we could see a correction in the urban residents bought second homes in a panic, only to have urban core quickly get vaccinized and normalized in 2021. He goes on to talk about New England beach town markets where we could see this. At KCM, what we look for are anomalies in the market. Anomalies have the potential to correct themselves. So when you look at the second home market last year, this is what it looks like. Mortgage growth in primary homes, second homes, and investment properties. The middle there's second homes. 2019 in blue, 2% growth in 2019. Oh, by the way, in 2020, second homes were, that market was forecasted to constrict. It grew by 27%. Those are people that left cities and said, you know what, we're going to buy. He's going to say, we want to get rid of that house, but some of them will. Some of them are getting safe, and they've got to get kids to basketball, and we've got to be here, and school's happening, and we've got this home. And oh, by the way, you can sell it. So that's an area right now. I'd be talking to people, and I'd say, hey, did you buy a home in the last year and a half that you've thought about selling? You know, you live in a second home market. You live in a market where people are buying second homes, which is all of us. I'd be having that conversation. But here's the reality of the second half. with all of the things, all of the increases in interest rates, the increases in prices, the inventory, don't miss this. Sales are forecasted to increase nicely this year and next. In 2020, we sold 6.5 million homes in this country. We're forecasted this year to sell 7 million homes. You can see the averages here. I'm gonna call this year, 2021, 7 million homes. The truth about the market this year is we will not reach the market potential because we can't sell what million homes. We sell more homes than we ever sold before. And again, in 2022, a very, very good year. Most of us would take last year over outside of the pandemic, but in our business, we'd take last year over. We had a very, very good year. And forecasters are saying that's here to stay, primarily because the need for housing has changed, and people have said, you know, we want something different. I'll end this little section here with what J.P. Morgan is telling their clients right now, and they're saying this. Interest rates are still historically low, though they're inching up. Housing prices have spiked during the last 6 to 9 months, but we don't expect them to fall soon, and we believe they're more likely to keep rising. If you're looking to purchase a new home, conditions now may be better than 12 months hence. It's one of the largest wealth managers buying, do it now. J.P. Morgan's telling their clients that. There will be headwinds in the second half of the year. I do believe that. And I think as agents, as leaders, we need to be prepared for those. So one of the things we say at KCM is that headlines do more to terrify than to clarify. And you need to be prepared for these. Because the job of the news is not to educate you or your client. The job of the news is to get you to watch more news. That's the reality of the world we live in today. And we have the tools to be able to get the word out there. Think about the last year. We've all been able to use Zoom. I've been on a ton of webinars talking about this is what we need to be talking about right now. Let's talk just a minute about what the headlines will be in the second half, because these are things we're going to want to be educated on to be able to coach agents, to coach buyers, to coach sellers. First is cash out refinances. You start to see cash out refinances. Here we go again. This is a look at cash out refinances going all the way back to the early 2000s. What stands out are the bars there in red, the peak bar in red, the height of the housing crash, $320 billion processed as cash out refinances in this country. The green bar there is the first quarter of this year, $41 billion cashed out as cash out refinances. Now, back in the housing crash, we know that people were taking equity out of their homes, they were buying jet skis, going on vacation, funding lifestyle, thinking this will never end. And we know it did end. And ever since there, I've said many times, people have handled equity differently coming out of the housing crisis, and you see it here. But yet people are tapping into that equity. Expect to see more and more talked about that. If you were to play that $41 billion out over the next three quarters and say, okay, let's say we see the same volume, maybe $164 billion this year, that's what that would look like. It's going to be higher than it was last year, and expect to see headlines, more cash out refinance in the last 10 years. Okay, be ready for that. But here's the truth. We're going to go back to our friend Bill McBride. For the first quarter of 2021, the net equity extraction was $41 billion, are 0.8% of disposable personal income. This is nothing like the amount of equity extraction during the housing bubble as a percentage of disposable personal income. Now, one thing, as you download these slides, in the notes of these slides are the links to these reports. If you wanna go back and read this report, I'd highly encourage you to jump into that if you want to. If you wanna take my word for it, back in 2006, cash out refinances were close to 10% of disposable personal income. We're nowhere near where we were back then with cash out refinances. But do I expect somebody to sit down in your office and say, you know what, I'm really worried. Here we go again with cash out refinances. I do. The other headline that I think you're going to see is monthly mortgage payments are increasing significantly. Since the average mortgage payment has grown by almost 20% in this country, expect to see that headline. There are two things we know about that. What people wanted in a home changed in 2020. I'm going to school there, I'm working there, I'm working out there, I'm eating there. All the things we know about what happened to home during the pandemic. The other thing family want and what they need. And we're seeing mortgage payments grow as a factor of that. The other piece that'll be a big talking point into the second half of the year will be affordability. You know, and if you followed KCM, you know we use NAR's Housing Affordability Index. The way you read this index is the higher the index, the more affordable the home is. And what jumps out to you are the orange bars in the middle where distressed and they are certainly homes were more affordable back then. But what you always want to look for when you're talking about affordability is what are we basing affordability on? So let me give you an example. Somebody comes and sits down with you and they're like, you know what, homes aren't as affordable today as they used to be. If you want to stop them in their tracks, the question you ask them, as compared to when? As compared to the last 2 years? I would agree with that. Homes aren't as affordable as they've been in the last 2 years. 3 years ago, they're actually more affordable than 3 years ago. Are they less affordable than back during the housing crisis? No, they're less affordable than then. But every year going all the way back to 1990, they're more affordable. So helping people understand affordability is based on three things: wages, interest rates, and prices. We've been the benefit over the last 12 months of low interest rates, rising wages, and it's been enough to offset rising prices. It hasn't affected us from an affordability standpoint. Now, there are two conversations in the market: affordability, which is what the dollar buys, and affordable housing. Two different conversations. Affordable housing refers to homes on the low end of the challenge before it gets better in the coming months and years as interest rates rise and as prices rise. In every one of these things we talked about, cash out refinances, rising mortgage payments, affordability, all they will do in the second half of this year is pour gas on the fire of, are we in a housing bubble? That is for sure. And I'll leave you with this. The Joint Center for Study for Housing at Harvard University just came out, State of the Nation's Housing 2021, and they said this: these outsized increases have raised concerns that a home price bubble is emerging. However, conditions today are quite different than in the early 2000s, particularly in terms of credit availability. The current climb in house prices instead reflects strong demand amid tight supply, helped along by record low interest rates. About our business, are we in a bubble? This is the type of information that we're gonna have to be strong on in the second half of the year as we communicate with clients. So Greer, I'm going to turn it back over to you. That's what we can see kind of coming into the second half of the year, some headwinds and some good things.
Well, that's incredible information. One, I do want to open it up. Do we have a mic? We do have a mic. So I would love to be able to just open it up for questions for y'all. I have one to start with. Inflation. You know, you're starting to see a lot of headlines around inflation that's happening out there. And is it an inflationary period, or, you know, how does that affect all of us?
It's a great question. If I was asked that question today, my first response would be the best fight against inflation and housing is a fixed mortgage rate,
yep.
Is fixed housing cost. So that'd be our first answer. Now, what we know about inflation right now is most economists are saying it's going to be transitory, meaning it's going to be here for a season, then we're going to move through it. I think the economy as a whole is facing what we are facing in housing, and that's a supply and demand imbalance.
That's
we're facing that in lumber. We're facing that in homes. Try to go out to a restaurant, they're facing it. New cars, used cars, we're facing a supply and demand imbalance. And oh, by the way, when we talked about the pandemic, nobody said, hey, what happens on the other side of this when we shut down the economy for however many months, or we reduce capacity for restaurants and other organizations? So most of the outlook is that we will move through it, but I think we have some time to get through that.
Yeah, so everything's got to spin back up. We got to get, you know, prices back in line. You know, things are got to be produced in order to get houses back online and more building occurring as well.
Yeah, and again, the biggest fighter of inflation is fixed housing cost.
Yep.
That's the benefit of home ownership.
Absolutely, absolutely. It's another great point to make.
Yeah.
Questions? I think Elizabeth has the mic over here.
I'm just wondering about any of the political changes, like the 1031 or tax laws. Do you foresee any of those changing the outlook?
So is it, the question is, do I foresee 1031 changing the outlook for real estate? So this is a good question, really good question. We've gotten that before. There's two things I would say about that. One, we typically will not comment on pending legislation. We live in a highly politicized world, as an understatement. What is proposed versus what comes out in legislation oftentimes are very, very different. That's the truth of the world we live in today. The second thing that we have to understand right now, the proposed legislation for 1031 exchanges affects those earning over $500,000 in that, so that's what's been proposed. The second thing is, the 1031 exchange in housing is the last man standing, so to speak, in the 1031 exchange. It's been in aircraft, it's been in agriculture, it's been in so many other industries, and it's been eliminated. Do I know if that proposed legislation is going to pass? I don't know, but the writing is on the wall that at some point it will be done away with, because they're looking for ways to fund programs and need the revenue to do that, and that's why they would do that. Now, I do believe the savvy investor is going to sit down with their accountant. If that would happen, and their accountant's going to say, this is what we're going to do now, and that's the reality.
All right.
How do you think these large institutional funds like BlackRock coming into the market, how do you think they're going to affect the market going forward, pouring billions of dollars into single-family rentals and purchasing?
So BlackRock, the money that they're putting into the market, how's that going to affect everything? Is that the essence of it? So there was a news story. I'm sure you saw BlackRock, injecting $6.5 billion in the market. Now, the interesting thing right now is that was for an acquisition. That was not to go out and purchase new homes. Those were homes that were already owned by an organization that BlackRock acquired. One of the things, and if you want to email me, I can send you this information. It's David at Keeping Current Matters, super easy to remember. A lot of people think that the institutional investor is buying a lot right now. They make up about 2% of the market. The overall majority of investors is, the activity is split between mom and pop investors in two categories: investors that are 1 to 10 units and 10 to 100 units. That is 98% of the market right now. So do I think those investors see housing as a great investment? Yes, I do. Are they making up the majority of the transactions? They're not. So we'll see what happens in the future. It's a good question. A lot of people are asking that BlackRock headline, you know, what's going to happen there.
Elizabeth, you're still out there. We have maybe quite time for one more question up front here.
You mentioned that builder confidence has slipped, and one of the reasons was land concerns. Do you have any examples of what land concerns you're referencing?
I can't.
Speak up a little bit louder.
sorry. You mentioned that builder confidence is slipping, mm-hmm. and I'm wondering what some of the land concerns they have are.
Well, that's a great question. So builders across the country, it's a tale of two cities. There are literally cities that builders have plenty of land that they can build in, and there are cities right now where the land is not available in the you know, the urban area, the metropolitan area of a city. So I think that's the biggest concern. Now, what I think you will see is migration from high price markets to low price markets. That's no doubt going to happen across the country. So I think it's primarily based upon the availability of land. I think no doubt in this room, you'd probably talk to people that said builders are building in my market and they're building like crazy, and others that would say builders aren't building because there's just not the availability of land.
Great question. Well, guys, well, David, first of all, thank you so much for being here. We love having you guys here.
Thank you. Thank you, Greg.
And, yeah, man, absolutely. And, yeah, y'all, this is, you know, honestly, Keeping Current Matters is where I go every single month to really make sure I'm understanding what's happening in the market. And you know, I think that the takeaway from that for me was, you know, just the points, the buyer points, and the fact that, you know, buying now is the right time to buy. You're leaving 90K on the table if you're not doing it now. Struggle through that multiple offer situation. And anyways, but once again, David, thank you so much.